apart from instituting counterclaims or revocation petitions to challenge the validity of the patent before the intellectual property board or the court that is seized of the issue of infringement, the defendant has certain other options which have been provided for under the Act. The first of which would be Section 107 under the head of defenses to a suit for infringement. What this provision basically does is this: it gives the defendant the option of not filing revocation petitions or counterclaims under Section 64 and merely raising defenses by invoking the grounds under Section 64 to challenge the validity of the patent. So in practical terms, how does this work out, or how does this play out? So when a defendant is called upon to file the written statement in response to the plaint of the patent in a suit for infringement, what the defendant could do is to basically, first of all, respond to the allegations relating to infringement, and also raise defenses under Section 107 by invoking grounds of invalidation under Section 64. So apart from having raised those defenses, the defendant is also expected to cite prior art to support each of those defenses. Now, the difference between a situation where the court is seized of a counterclaim and a suit for infringement, and where the where a court is merely seized of a situation where the defendant has raised grounds under Section 107 without filing a counterclaim, is this: in the former, the court has the power to revoke the patent since a counterclaim has been filed seeking revocation of the patent, whereas in the latter, it is not the revocation that is sought. Instead, what is sought is non-enforcement of the patent in light of the defenses or the grounds of vulnerability that have been pointed out by the defendant. Therefore, although this appears to be a technical difference, this is a very real limitation on the power of a court to revoke a patent if the defendant does not institute a counterclaim for the revocation of a patent before the court. As far as Section 107 is concerned, one of the questions that could be raised is, or this is a question that can also be raised with respect to Section 64. Is it possible for a defendant to go beyond the grounds which have been provided for under Section 64 or 107 to challenge the validity of a patent? The answer has to be a straightforward no, for the simple reason that Section 64 makes it abundantly clear through its language that the grounds that have been provided for to challenge the validity of a patent under the provision are exhaustive in nature. Since Section 107 limits itself to the grounds that have been provided for or enumerated under Section 64, it is not possible for a defendant who invokes a defense under Section 107 to go beyond the grounds that have been provided for under Section 64. This aspect of the issue has been interpreted by the Division Bench of the Delhi High Court. In fact, it was done way back in 1996 in the case of Franz Xaver Huemer versus New Yush Engineers, where it was sought to be argued by the defendants that it is permissible for them to go beyond the grounds of Section 64 when a defense is raised under Section 107. Interpreting both the provisions, the court arrived at the conclusion that since Section 107 refers to or incorporates by reference Section 64, the grounds of Section 64 circumscribe the grounds of the defenses that are available under Section 107. Does this mean that it is impermissible for a defendant to raise grounds which are not available under Section 107 or Section 64? No. Should the defendant place reliance on issues or facts which go beyond Section 107, then it is possible for the defendant to place a combined reliance on Section 107 and those aspects which are foreign to 107. What it simply means is that if the defendant chooses to place reliance or invoke Sections 107 alone, then he cannot introduce grounds or facts which are alien to Section 64. However, if he chooses to use Section 107 as one of the defenses available to him in a suit for infringement, then he can use grounds which are not available under Section 64 as well. So, for instance, if there are aspects related to a patentee's conduct, either before the patent office, which are not necessarily grounds of revocation under Section 64, or in the market, which are not necessarily grounds under Section 64, apart from raising grounds under Section 64 and reading them along with 107, it is absolutely within the rights of the defendant to point out to those aspects of the patentee's conduct which have a bearing on aspects of equity, which in turn have a bearing on the grant of an interim injunction. So, for instance, if during the course of the examination of a patent, or a patent application, the patentee chooses to not comply with the directions issued by the controller or the examiner to rectify certain objections, and yet somehow the patent office goes on to grant the patent, it is permissible for the defendant to point to those aspects of the patentee's conduct and seek refusal of an interim injunction on the ground that the improper examination of the patent, although not a ground for revocation under Section 64, certainly gives rise to a certain element of doubt with regard to the grant of the patent, and therefore the court should not or ought not to enforce the patent. Now, the court could ask itself a simple question. If a certain ground or a certain aspect does not ultimately translate into a ground for revocation of the patent, on what basis can a defendant place reliance on it to prevent the grant of an injunction? Here's where an alternative remedy needs to be discussed. Assuming that a patent has been granted in compliance with, at least in letter, of all the provisions of the Act, but still ultimately militates the object of the Act one way or the other, it is potentially open for a defendant or a third party to file or institute a writ petition seeking the interference of the writ court in a situation where a court cannot otherwise revoke the patent or any other firm cannot otherwise revoke the patent using statutory grounds. So one instance could be this. If a patent application was taken up for examination after the expiry of the term of the patent itself, would it be possible for a third party to challenge the examination and subsequent grant of a patent on the ground that although there is no express provision under Section 64 to challenge the grant of a patent on grounds that it has been granted or examined after the expiry of its term, it could still invoke a writ petition as an option to challenge the validity of a patent? This is something that has happened in the past where the patent office has taken up applications which have expired and has gone on to examine and grant those patents after the expiry of the term. In such a situation, it can be nobody's case that merely because this is not a ground for revocation under Section 64, the public or third parties have to suffer the continued subsistence of the patent on the register of the patents. Now, this is insofar as the grounds of defense, the grounds or defenses to a suit for infringement is concerned. Another interesting defense which warrants serious attention is Section 107A of the Patents Act. Section 107A has two aspects, the first of which is known as the Bolar exemption, and the second is popularly projected as the parallel import defense, which I humbly beg to differ with. As far as the first Bolar exemption is concerned, it provides that it is absolutely within the rights of a third party to use a patented invention to the extent that the use is restricted to generation of regulatory information to bodies inside or outside India or for the purposes of research. As far as the second defense is concerned, which is Section 107AB, the popular assumption or the myth, at least in my opinion, is that Section 107AB refers to parallel imports and it permits a defendant to import a patentee's product from a foreign jurisdiction without attracting allegations of infringement. My humble submission is that this is a policy-based reading of the provision, which has got nothing to do with the actual language of the provision or the legislative history of this particular provision. I have written in detail on this particular aspect of the issue where I have gone on to say categorically that Section 107 has got nothing to do with parallel importation by way of international exhaustion. The problem with the interpretation or the popular conception is it assumes that parallel importation is only by way of international exhaustion and there can be no other legal means to import parallelly the patented product. If one were to look into the legislative history of the amendment of Section 107AB in 2005 and the parliamentary debates on this issue, it actually points to a different scenario where all that the provision permits or empowers the government to do is to give the rights to manufacture the product to a foreign party so that the product may be imported at a cheaper price. And this is to be done in a situation when there is absolutely no domestic party who is in a position to manufacture the patented product through the compulsory licensing mechanism. In other words, this is a reverse or the converse of Section 92A. Now, this is a discussion for another day. Be that as it may, I would fervently and sincerely request readers to pay attention to Section 107A and follow the debate on this particular provision, because it has serious implications for public interest as well as for the rights of the patentee. Whichever way this may go, ultimately what one must understand is that there cannot be any policy-based discussion on a statutory provision without reference to the language of the provision, without reference to those permitted aids which help us understand the actual import of the provision. Therefore, if one has to really understand the provision, and assuming that there is an ambiguity in the language, then the maximum that one can go to reduce this ambiguity or to eliminate this ambiguity are internal and external aids of interpretation. But policy arguments cannot be used to advance a position which does not find any resonance with the language of the provision. Now, this is with respect to the defenses. The one thing that I would urge students of patent law to understand is that ultimately patent law is law, although it is law that deals with science. In which case, whenever we discuss patent infringement or patent litigation in general, it is important for students to first of all be at home with certain aspects of litigation, which is procedure, which would mean a fair amount of familiarity with the Code of Civil Procedure and the Evidence Act. Besides that, it is strongly urged that students are completely at home with doctrines and principles of equity, which are frequently used and which are frequently relevant in any litigation, and patent litigation is no exception to this proposition. Therefore, anybody who is interested in taking up patent litigation as a choice of career, I would seriously urge them to start understanding principles of property first, elements of property jurisprudence first, principles of equity first, before they proceed to understand patent law. Because at the end of the day, patent law is not a peculiar exception to principles of property jurisprudence or equity, which have been well settled for all these years and centuries. Therefore, if one has to seriously understand the subject in all its in a very comprehensive fashion, the approach cannot be to read the Patents Act alone in a blinkered fashion. There has to be a conscious effort to tie this with other aspects of general litigation, such as constitution, because there is also the element of access to medicines that has to be understood from a constitutional standpoint, the right to health, the right to life, so on and so forth. Plus, there has to be an effort to understand how do equitable principles, when it comes to grant of equitable reliefs, such as interim injunctions, play out in the context of patents. Is there a significant departure when it comes to patent law? To summarize what I have said, no discussion of the Patents Act is complete without a reference to the Act and the express provisions and the language of the provisions. That said, no understanding of the subject as a whole is complete without reference to general principles of property and general principles of equity. Thank you.